Hey everyone, welcome to this special edition video where I'll be sharing with you my current process for how I make tutorial videos just like the ones you see on my channel. I'll show you everything I use for this, including all of the equipment and software. I'll also show you how I'm using AI and custom automation to generate all the slides you see in the video and to automatically cut and label the raw footage. All of this has helped me to optimize my video production workflow, reducing a process that originally took 2 months for just one video down to just under a week. I know this is a little different to what I normally do on this channel, but I thought it'd be fun to document my current process as of today, and then in the future, it'd be interesting to look back and see how that's changed. So let's get started. Here's a very high-level overview of the entire process. I break it up into three distinct phases, which is writing, recording, and editing. In the writing phase, I create all of the content, the coding, the transcript, and the images. Pretty much everything that you'll see in the video itself. This is currently the longest part and usually takes about 3 to 4 days. Next, I'll record the whole video in one sitting. This usually only takes a few hours, but it's also the hardest part of the process because I have to be really focused that entire time. After that, I'll do all the editing and all the YouTube metadata, like subtitles and chapter tags. This used to be the longest part of the process, but now it only takes about a day. I spend a lot of time thinking about how to use technology to improve or automate this process because I don't have a lot of spare time to spend on making these videos, so I have to make the most of it. So over time, I've created some custom tooling in Python to help me with things that are time consuming, like generating the slide images or automatically cutting the video for me. The steps I've highlighted in red are the ones where I use some level of AI or custom automation to help me with the heavy lifting. Now let's go ahead and dive into each of these phases one by one. The first and most important phase, in my opinion, is the writing. I want my viewers to walk away with the knowledge or the solution that they want in as little time as possible. This usually starts with the project or the topic idea for the video. For this, I just use an Excel spreadsheet to jot down a bunch of different topics. And these topics are usually something recommended to me by my viewers in the video comments, or sometimes it's just the topic I'm personally interested in and want to learn it for myself as well. I also use an SEO tool called VidIQ to find the level of demand for these topics, as well as the amount of competition. That way, I can get a rough sense of what might be a good topic for the channel. In reality, though, I found that there's not that strong of a connection between this data and the actual performance of a video. So I try not to over-index on this, and sometimes I just have to go with my gut. Once I've selected an idea, I'll code up an example project for the tutorial. This is the part I enjoy the most because I usually get to be hands-on with the code and sometimes discover or learn something new for myself as well. And depending on the size and scope of the project itself, I could end up spending anywhere between several hours to several weeks, like in this Pokemon card generation video. As of today, this project is probably still the favorite one that I've worked on for this channel. I also make sure that the actual code and the project I work on during the video is also uploaded to GitHub. So I actually end up making two copies of the project. One is the first one where I'm kind of experimenting for myself, and then that's the one where I base the video on. And then there'll be another one that I'm developing as part of the video itself. That's the one I end up uploading because that's what I want people to see when they're watching the video. They can just click on the GitHub link and then have the real code that is actually used in the video. For coding the project itself, I use VS Code. I personally like it a lot, but it's also the most popular editor, which makes the video relatable to more people. I also rely quite heavily on ChatGPT and GitHub Copilot to help me get through the project quickly, especially if I'm using frameworks or libraries I've never used before. And since quite a lot of people ask me about my VS Code theme, it's called Monokai Pro. It's available to try out for free, but I actually did pay for it because I like it so much. Once the project is finished and uploaded to GitHub, I'll move on to writing the transcript for the video. I use an app called Obsidian, which is a free markdown editor. I start by breaking it up into sections and then adding in code snippets, links, and data. Then I'll go through and pretty much script out everything I'm gonna say, word for word. The challenge is that I want to sound like I'm speaking naturally, but at the same time, I want the video to deliver its learning objective as quickly as possible. So it's just this never-ending struggle between clarity, speed, and sounding natural. Once I've completed the script, I'll use a custom Python program to generate all of the slides for the video. This is going to go through the markdown transcript that you saw being written earlier and then break it down into different sections that it will use to generate as a slide. For example, things like headers, list, tables, these are things it figures out from looking at the markdown, and then it'll turn those into separate slides. So after I run that script, I just have this directory with a bunch of PNG images based on code snippets, titles, list, pictures that I've used in the original script. This way, I don't have to generate my slides separately in a different software. I just write the script once as a markdown file, and this is just all produced as part of the process automatically. And here we'll just take a look at the Python program that does this. So the key to this is that because the transcript is in a markdown format, we can actually convert it to HTML and then parse that HTML using Beautiful Soup. So things like headers will translate into H1, H2, H3 headings. And then depending on the type of HTML element we have, we can start to generate different slides. So whenever we find a new element, like a header or a list or a code block, we can use some special logic to extract the content in that element and turn it into an image. So now I'm showing you my actual markdown file, but also the image that's generated as a result of that element. So this is actually, what you're looking now is actually the script I'm using for this very video. And here's my header element. So after I run this through my slide generation script, it will detect that this is a header and it will generate an image like this. And a list will become something like this. So I just write this normally as markdown and I will get this produced out of it. And this is the most useful one for me as well, is the code block, because I tend to use a lot of different code examples in my video tutorials. So this is really helpful to have on the screen. So I can just write it as a code block like this. I can comment which language, it's usually going to be Python or TypeScript, and then that will highlight it properly using this language's syntax. Behind the scenes, I use Python's Pigments library to generate the actual code image, so this thing here, and then I use the Pillow library to make it get the right size so that the code fits into the screen so that there's enough padding, and then I also add this stuff around it to make it look like it's in a terminal window. And finally, I've also added support for tables as well, just like this one, since I find that that's quite useful for videos where I have to show or compare data. To generate all of these images from the HTML, I use Python's imaging library, also known as Pillow. And there's no single step that's super complicated on its own, but it's just a lot of little details to pay attention to. For example, finding the optimal font size, how to add emojis to the slide, adding things like shadows and color gradients. And to top it off, if I have any screenshots like this before after picture here, I can dump it into the images folder in my project, and the program will also wrap it up in the channel's branding so that everything has a consistent style and color. So you can see that the screenshot now is kind of in the middle. There's a bit of a border and a shadow around it, and it just kind of fits in, and there's the channel's logo at the bottom left corner. This also works for things like charts or diagrams I generated as well. The program automatically wraps it up in this theme or template, and I think it's just nice to have a consistent visual style across all of the slides and the content that you see. Once I have the script and the supporting image assets, I'm ready to record the video. I always try to do this in one sitting because I find it's really hard to stop halfway through a video and then pick it up again with the same pace and tone. I use a Razer webcam, a couple of lights, and a mounted Yeti microphone. For my recording software, I use OBS Studio, which is free on all platforms. And I've also pre-configured a bunch of scenes on it too, like this one where it's the slide and there's like the webcam in the corner, or this one where it's just the full webcam on its own. I also have this Stream Deck that gives me physical buttons to switch quickly between different scenes or to pause the recording. The result is usually one long, uninterrupted video, and it's never perfect. There's always a lot of mistakes, awkward pauses, or entire sections I have to repeat. So I sometimes have an hour-long video that will eventually be cut down to 10 to 15 minutes in the next step. The editing phase was originally the most time-consuming phase in the process, because I had to go through the whole video and just keep watching and trimming it for hours. So this is the first thing I wanted to automate well. I now have a program to do the entire first edit of the video for me, which saves a lot of time. I still have to go through the whole thing again though to touch it up manually, but it's a lot easier than starting from scratch. I then run my own translation workflow on the video so people in different countries can watch them, and I also use a little bit of automation to help me figure out the chapter names and timings to use. Probably the biggest time saver for me is the auto-editing workflow. This is also by far the part of the process where I've invested most of my time into developing. Once I have my video recording file from the previous step, I run the auto-edit command, which will go through a bunch of different steps depending on which phase of production the project is in. This will eventually generate a Final Cut Pro XML file with the entire sequence cut up for me. Each segment will usually represent one sentence, so it's easy to scrub through them. And the segments will be labeled either yellow, green, or red. The green parts are the good segments. The yellow parts are the ones with long pauses or silences. And the red parts are the ones that probably should be deleted, either because it was a mistake or it was because something I ended up repeating later on. Most of the time, to get to the final edit, all I have to do is just keep all of the green parts and delete everything else. Then I'll watch it through again to validate and make some minor adjustments, or maybe restore a deleted section that was accidentally mislabeled by the tool. So how do we get to this? First, I start by using a local copy of Whisper to transcribe the whole video. This will give me a subtitle or a .srt file with the lines and the timestamps. I can then use this to figure out where to cut the original video so that each section is a separate sentence. Next, I need to turn it into a format that any video editing program can understand. I use Adobe Premiere, but Final Cut Pro's XML format is well documented and pretty much understood by any video editing software. So I generate an XML file that contains all of these editing instructions. Now I have to figure out which sections are mistakes or bad takes. We'll label these red. There's two ways I can detect this. First is a hard-coded poison pill. So basically, anytime I say these words that you see on the screen out loud, it will be detected and marked as a red segment. And here's an example of a line that's been edited out because I've used that phrase at the end of the second sentence. If those words appear anywhere in a sentence, that entire sentence will be edited out, which is why I can't really say it right now because my auto-edit program will probably pick it up. Alternatively, if I make a mistake recording something, I'm likely to re-record the same line immediately after. Or sometimes it's not a mistake, but when I say something out loud, I don't really like the way it sounds, so I try to say it in a different way. To solve this, I calculate the vector embeddings of every line, and if there's a sequence of segments with similar embeddings, then I only keep the last one. So you can see in this example, line 22 was edited out because it's very similar to line 23. In other words, it means that if there's multiple sentences in a row that have a similar meaning, we could probably assume that the last one is the one we should use. Next, to detect silent segments, we just look at the audio waveform for the duration of that segment, and then use some Python libraries to figure out if it's silent or not. We'll label those yellow. Likely, I'll also want to delete those segments in the final edit. By the end of the auto-editing process, I'll have an XML file that contains all of the editing instructions for the video. I can import this into Adobe Premiere, and then I just go through watching the whole thing, deleting and trimming the segments where needed. Recently, I've been outsourcing the manual editing process to a freelance editor as well to save time. So to make that process a little bit easier, I have my script also upload the video file and the XML file to Amazon S3 so that I can just copy-paste the links to my editor right away. Once the final cut of the video is completed, I run it through another Python script which lets me transcribe and translate the whole thing into a bunch of different languages. I do this using ChatGPT behind the scenes, but I still have to write some logic for it so that the translations work well with the subtitle timings and also that it can be processed quickly and in parallel. I also found it really interesting that I had to give additional instructions for certain languages, especially ones that have a more formal tone by default, but that's not really the tone I want to use in my video, so I have to explicitly prompt ChatGPT that I want to use an informal tone or a casual tone for that language. After running this, I'll get about 10 different language files And then I just use a Python script to call YouTube's API and upload them to the video. And for the final phase of this video, it's just getting the video description and metadata. For example, things like the chapter timings and the chapter labels. While I'm editing the video, I'll also add these colored labels to indicate where a chapter begins and ends. I'll export this all as part of an XML file, so the same Final Cut Pro XML format you saw earlier. And that way, I can use a Python script to figure out the timings of these chapters. Once I have the timings, I can get the transcript of that entire chapter from my subtitle file, and then I'll feed that into ChatGPT and tell it to give me a chapter title based on the content. The results aren't perfect, but they're usually close enough. So all I have to do is just edit the line of the title to the one I really want. And that's what you end up seeing in the video's description. Now, with all of these processes, it seems that there's actually quite a lot of different steps and things going on. But in reality, once it's all been coded up, all of this automation is pretty much happening in just one click. You run the command and it just starts the process, whether it's the slide generation, the transcription, the auto editing, translation, or chapter labeling. It does everything it can, just one by one, sequentially, one at a time, until it actually gets to a point where it requires more user input. Currently, writing the code for the project and writing the transcript itself is now the longest and most challenging part of the process for me. So this is what I'll probably be looking to automate next. I've tried it a few times before, but I haven't really been able to get it to generate something of the same tone and quality as when I'm just writing it manually. However, bigger and more powerful LLM models are being released every month, so we'll see if that changes anything. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed watching this, and I'll see you in the next one.